Are you ready? Sea of Red, it's time for another episode of Fireside Chat.
We're back. It's Dan and Matt here for Fireside Chat. How you doing, Matt?
Good. Good start to the new year. Getting a lot of stuff done, and things are looking good on my end.
Good. Not looking so good for the Flames for the start of the new year. If we look at all the games since 2016, we're 2-2 right now. 2 wins and 2 losses. So we're 500 on the year so far.
Yeah, 2 losses in a row in the most recent games. Not such a good week this week.
Let's talk about the games this week. We had 3 games that the Flames played this week. And back on Tuesday, the Tampa Bay Lightning came to town. This is a game where you and I thought that we might have seen a Drouin trade before the game, but we didn't. And the Lightning came in, and the Flames ended up beating them 3-1 in that game. The Lightning outshot us, but we got better. We had, I think, better quality shots. It was 31 shots to 24. What were your thoughts on this one, Matt?
I thought the Flames played a really solid, composed game. They didn't panic. They didn't let Tampa really get too many quality chances. Like, they did direct a lot of shots at the net, but there wasn't a lot of dangerous chances in my mind, and I thought the Flames did a very good job of boxing them out and not allowing guys like Stamkos or Johnson or Palat to sneak behind defenders and all that, so.
Yeah, I think that's the big thing when you play the Lightning is you have to be able to play that kind of game and keep their guys to the boards, and the Flames did that really well. I think we have to give credit to Kerry Ramo again. Another great performance from the Flames starter.
Yeah, he's been really one of the top goalies in the NHL since the beginning of December.
Yeah, and it's weird because when you look around the league at the names and the goaltenders who, you know, the goaltenders who are out there and who are playing for top teams, you would not expect Kerry Ramo to be one of those guys.
No, like I saw an infographic. I was watching the Canucks play a couple days ago and against the Panthers, and I think Ramo was the second best goaltender since the beginning of December, only behind Luongo, and the Panthers, of course, were on an absurd winning streak, so.
The Panthers are doing some amazing things in their own right this year.
Which it's nice to see for their fans. Finally, after 20 years of being a laughingstock, they're actually doing something.
Yeah, I know that you're a Panthers fan.
Yeah, it's been nice to see.
And, I got to give credit. I think we're seeing a bit of a resurgence of Roberto Luongo, too. I thought his career was kind of going to Florida to die off, and we're seeing some good play from him this year.
Mm-hmm.
Looking at the other 2 games, after the Tampa Bay game, the Flames had the Arizona Coyotes come to town. This is a game that we weren't sure when you and I were doing our predictions what would happen with this one. We both thought that they could win this game because Arizona is, let's just say they're a team that no one expected to do much this year. And we ended up losing 2-1 in this game. Calgary came out, got the early goal. Arizona got a goal in the first. There was no scoring in the second, and Martin Hanzel put it away in the third period.
Yeah, Dave Tippett is the best defensive coach in the NHL, and he really knows how to shut the whole thing down for any offensive chances coming their way, and that typically leads to boring games, and I think the Arizona game was one in that style. It's unfortunate that the Flames weren't able to capitalize. I think that was a game that they probably should have won, but they didn't get the bounces that going their way, and they ended up on the losing end of it.
Yeah, no, I think you're right. I mean, the Flames were playing, I think, as well as they could, but Arizona's system, very similar to what we did to Tampa Bay, Arizona was just playing a system that didn't give us a lot of time in front.
No, and Arizona's classically a counterpunch team, and they wait for you to make a mistake, and they go up on the rush and try to score. So the fact that the Flames are kind of the same style, although they do it slightly differently, it makes it a lot more difficult for the Flames to play outside of their own comfort zone, because they have to drive the play instead of reacting to the other team like they usually do.
Yeah, no, you're totally right. And I think, you know, I was at this game. This is one of the few games that I've been to lately. I think the Flames were... I've heard some people say the Flames played a bad game, and they didn't. I think that Arizona's goalie played a really good game.
Yeah.
He's not a goalie I'm all that familiar with.
No.
And he played above his level. The Flames, we saw a lot of the Flames winning a lot of faceoffs, I noticed in my notes, that we were doing a lot of those small things right. We were winning the faceoffs, we were playing the way we could, but we could not get men in front of the net.
No.
And couldn't get a lot of really good quality shots because
of it. And the odd time that the Flames did get good shots, Demig was there to stop them, and he played one of the better games I've seen from an opposing goalie this season. I was actually somewhat surprised at the time that they started what I was assuming was their backup, because it's such an important interdivisional game. And then I saw him play, and I'm like, oh, okay, that's why. So I think he might end up becoming their starter moving forward, as they may look to move Mike Smith, possibly. Especially if he continues to play like he did in that game.
I've never been a huge fan of Mike Smith. So I always thought he was an okay goalie. I think he's very similar to a guy like Dubnyk to me, where I think he's had a couple good years, but he's still not a proven number one.
No, and if you look around the league, anytime you have a goalie that's that big, you can get away with a lot of things just because of your size and the pucks hitting you versus you stopping them. And yeah. I think Smith is probably the worst of the large goalies that are currently in the league. But still, he takes up a huge amount of the net, so it makes everything a little more difficult.
Yeah, for sure. Nice to see some of the young players in Arizona, though. I really enjoyed seeing Max Domi. I always like to see Shane Doan play. Ekman Larson. They've got some good players in that team, and I think until you see them live, it's easy to underestimate a little bit of what they've actually got there in Arizona, and you start to understand why they're doing so well. They're not the best offensive team, but they play a heck of a defensive game, and it's leading to better chances for
them. Yeah, and Arizona's always, ever since Dave Tippett's been there, they've always punched above their weight. And if you look at their teams, like even when they went to the Western Conference Finals a couple of years ago, there was not a lot of talent on the team, but their system is so good that if they did have talent, say he got fired and was put on a team sort of like LA or something like that, that team would be the favorite to win the cup just because you have the talent and the defensive structure. And Arizona has always been kind of a mediocre team, even when they did have success. So now that they're getting some good young players into the system, I would not be surprised if moving forward they become one of the better teams in our division just because of how good they are at playing that stifling defensive style.
And they really have a good all-around team. You know, we talked about the goaltender. They've got, you know, some good veterans there. They've got guys like Vermette, Bodker, Doan, and they have some great defensive guys.
Yeah.
You know, Grossman, I think, does good work for
Mahalik.
Them. Mahalik, Ekman, Larson. So it's not like Edmonton where we're seeing, you know, one side of the ice, the forward side, being quite, you know, beefed up and not the defense. They've really got a good overall team there in Arizona.
Yeah, and anytime you have a lopsided team like the Oilers, it makes everything more difficult just due to not being able to deploy an overall game. You have to just kind of focus on the one thing and hope that the other parts where you're lacking don't screw you out of 2 points at the end of the night. And the Oilers, they should have been in on that Seth Jones trade because they had enough pieces that would have made it enticing for Nashville, but Yeah, it's Edmonton. But that's another whole hour-long discussion.
Yeah, and who knows what's going on? Who knows, you know, what offers were made? We're not privy to a lot of that information.
No.
And then the final game the Flames played this week was the San Jose game. This was quite an exciting game, I think, for people to watch. I didn't see the first period. I only saw part of the second period. Couldn't watch the third period due to some personal things that were going on with me. But San Jose got up early with a two-goal lead. The Flames came back and made it 2-1. Going into the second period, it was 3-1 San Jose after an early goal. And Calgary came back and really made this a 3-3 tie. And by the end of the second, I would say, I don't know about you, this was Calgary's game to lose.
Yeah, they had all the momentum, especially after the Bennett goal. They looked like they were close to scoring a fourth and maybe a fifth goal before the end of the second period. They just couldn't beat Jones. And that lack of actually capitalizing on those chances is what did them in.
I think, too, San Jose spent way too much time in the penalty box in this one.
Well, not really. I think they only had three penalties all game. It's just that two of them came, like, right at the same time, so they ended up being shorthanded for 2 full minutes.
I guess maybe I should restate that. You're right. They didn't have a lot of penalties, but they had them at the wrong times.
And when's the last time you can remember the Flames actually going 3-for-3 on the power play?
I can't even think about it. I think, it had to have been a long time ago.
Yeah.
I think I have the stat here. The last time the Flames had any sort of multi-power play goal game was in 2007 against San Jose.
Huh.
So it's come full circle, but that's, what, almost 6 years ago.
Yeah.
That's crazy. The fact that, you know, we're not, much less three, we're getting, you know, more than one power play goal. That's crazy.
Yeah, that is strange.
It just shows the special teams hasn't, I guess, been a
strength for a very long time.
Strength here or focus here.
Yeah. Well, I can remember back 10 years ago, all the fans complaining about the anemic power play, so makes sense.
I don't think that special teams has ever been something that the Calgary Flames have been known for.
No.
So after those three games with one win and two losses this week, we look at where the Flames are in the standings. And if we look at the Western Conference, the Flames are now sitting at 40 points, 1 point behind Winnipeg and 3 points above Edmonton. We're in seventh place and we're 4 points out of the Pacific Division standings and 5 points out of the wild card. So we're 4 points behind Vancouver for third in Pacific and 5 points out of the wild card. So, I mean, Matt, we've talked as we've gone up and down. This is, I think, the most points out we've talked about the Flames being. We're about 4 or 5 points out right now.
Since the winning streak, really.
Since the winning streak, yeah. And that's, to me, that's not a good sign.
No.
I mean, we went on that winning streak. We were excited. We were moving up there. Now we're 3 points back from Edmonton, or 3 points up from Edmonton. And I think we're starting to see, as you and I have talked about, what this team really is. You know, going 2-for-2 so far this year, looking at the schedule ahead, I think the Flames may end up struggling to get into a playoff spot.
Yeah, and realistically, the Flames needed to win 7 or 8 of the 11 games that they play this month just due to the quality of the opponents, and they needed at least to win 3 of the 4 to start the month, and yeah, we're 2-2, so unless the Flames go on a protracted winning streak, it'll be a lot more difficult for the team to actually find success moving forward, just due to the fact that we play a lot more quality teams in both in February and March, where we're kind of skating by, only playing a couple, I think, this month that are on the top half of the standings, so.
Well, and we got some hot teams coming,
true,
too. I mean, you know, we talked about Florida. We got Florida coming up. Edmonton, hopefully we can beat. We've got the Devils coming up. The Devils are a hot team right now. Columbus, I think, after the trade is going to be hot. So this next couple weeks, it could be a struggle for the Flames.
Exactly. And if they don't pull up their socks quickly, it's gonna be really tough for them to catch up, and that might not necessarily be the worst thing in the world if they do struggle. Like, currently, they're only ahead of four teams in the entire NHL. 1 point up on Toronto, 3 on Edmonton, and I think 4 or 6 on Buffalo and Columbus. So, if the Flames do go on, say, like a 4 or 5 game losing streak, the Flames could easily be in like 29th or 30th. So, it's unusual because the Flames are so close to both the top and the bottom. It makes it difficult to determine what direction this team will actually go.
Yeah, and we've said it, you know, since the win streak started, that December was a good month. January is really when the Flames had to put up or shut up and see what we've got. And based on, I mean, it's a very small sample size of 4 games, but looking at the results of those 4 games looking ahead, I think that we may be seeing that the Flames are going to go back to not as bad a pace as we had at the beginning of the year, but going back to being a team that might struggle to find wins down the stretch.
Yeah, and if you look at Kari Ramo, if he even just returns to being a 9-10 save percentage goalie instead of the nearly 940 save percentage goalie that he's been since the beginning of December, how many more goals and games are the Flames going to lose because of that?
Yeah.
And anytime you have a player or players that are extremely hot, like Gaudreau winning the Player of the Month last month, if they start to cool off, you need other players to step up, and we haven't really seen much of evidence of that, at least in the 4 games to start this month.
Well, and that's interesting that you mentioned that. I mean, we've seen some injuries in the last couple games, and we saw the Flames give Micheal Ferland a chance in the first line playing with Gaudreau Monahan in the Sharks game. What did you think of his performance on that line?
I think for the time being, he's got a spot there, and he scored a goal, got an assist, and looked quite effective there. And if the Flames are going to, later on in the season, move on from Yuri Hudler, they will need to see if there's anyone in the organization that could possibly take his spot. So if Ferland does have success, say, in the Florida game tomorrow and moving forward, then that at least helps you know that, okay, this guy can do this, and maybe we shift our attention over here instead. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I agree with you, but I don't think that Ferland is the right guy going forward. I don't think he's a top 6, much less a top 3 forward at this point in his career. I think he's going to work there for a couple games, and we've seen that in the past where a guy will be brought up for a couple games, but I don't think that we look at him as being the top guy going forward.
And that's the likeliest situation. Anytime you're dealing with anybody, really, unless they magically tap into something when they're given the opportunity, usually what they were prior to that is what they are. But he's getting a shot, and we'll see. I agree with you. I don't think that he's going to be the long-term fit on that line. But if it works for a couple of games, that's better than nothing.
And if nothing else, it might give him some confidence going forward that when he gets moved back to the second or the third line, that he has that confidence he needs to play a bit more of an offensive game. I think that we're seeing that Frolik is almost ready. I think that once Frolik is ready, he's going to be the guy that's going to get a look at the first line.
Yeah, and Hudler's going to be going tomorrow against Florida, so that is also likely a possibility as well. Like, especially if Ferland struggles in the game against Florida in the first period or something like that, I could see Hartley being ruthless and making the switch.
Yeah, well, you got to do what you got to do to win, especially at this point.
Yeah.
Matt, we've talked about the standings and where the Flames are in the standings, but it's interesting to also look not just at the standings, but because we are so close to the bottom of the league, and especially the bottom of the Western Conference right now, what we might be able to get in the draft if the Flames were to, you know, be drafting in that top 10. And you and I were both looking at Craig Button's list, the Craig Button. I find the Craig's usually pretty accurate with the actual order that guys are going to go. But he's posted his new list of where he thinks players are set up for his January rankings. And we've talked, especially you, about how the Flames need a right winger in the system. If you take a look at the top 10 guys, most of them are right wingers or defensemen. We've got Austin Matthews, who's a center. The next couple guys are right wingers. We've got Alex Nylander, who can play either wing, and then we got four defensemen ranked in a row.
Yeah, and a guy like either Jesse Puljujarvi or Patrick Laine, who both starred really well in the World Junior Championships for Finland, propelling them to the gold medal. I think either one of those players would look really good in a Flames jersey. They're both 6'3", 6'4", scoring types. So if the Flames do bottom out, at least there's a consolation prize of the possibility of getting a big right winger to put opposite Gaudreau on the first line.
Yeah, I mean, there's always the question that comes up is, do we draft by need or do we draft by position? But I think, you know, or best available, I should say, not position. Do we draft by need of position or do we draft by best available? But I think you might be able to get the best of both right now, looking at these, of not going off the board and picking a right winger who might be, you know, 21st or 22nd just to get the winger. And I like both guys you mentioned. I think, you know, Jesse Puljujarvi is 6'3.5", a nice big kid. Patrick Laine is 6'4". We know the Flames like their big kids, so I think we might get a very Calgary-looking player either way.
Yeah.
And both those guys play in Europe in a men's league, too, which I think always helps your development.
Yes, and it wouldn't be the best scenario for the Flames fans in terms of entertainment if they are in a situation where they can pick either of those players. But we are already near the bottom anyway, so if this continues where, like at the trade deadline, we're still out of it, I think the Flames will probably move more players than what we normally would have and target one of those players. And worst case scenario, if the Flames aren't in a position to select one of those guys, there's also the possibility of selecting a big defenseman. And if not that, like if the Flames do make the playoffs, there's a guy that's ranked 15th who is familiar to Flames fans. He's Dennis Gauthier's son.
Julien Gauthier.
Julien, yeah. And he's ranked 15th in Button's rankings. And he's another 6'3.5" right winger. So there's possibilities. Like, you obviously don't go for position just to take the one guy just because he's a right winger or just because he's a defenseman, but it's a nice thing that the need and the available talent is seeming to be overlapping this time.
Yeah, for sure. And I think, you know, I have more confidence in the Flames system right now as well for developing young players than I have for a lot of years in the past. And I think even if we were to, you know, draft someone 15th like Julien Gauthier, who might not be as polished as some of the other guys, I think the Flames can develop them the way they would need to be developed. I mean, we're seeing guys who we wouldn't expect to have the development curve they are developing quite well.
I can agree with that.
You know, not everybody. You're always going to have hits and misses.
Oh, no, of course. Like, you can't hit the lottery every single time you go up to the draft table. Like, give me a break.
And even every first-round pick can't always pan out to be a top three star. But I think if you look at most of the guys in the top 15, 20 in this ranking for this year, I think most of them are going to end up being NHL regulars.
Yeah, and when you're getting into the later part of that, you're more looking at guys of the talent level of Backlund or Poirier or Klimchuk, that they're okay, but you're likely getting guys that are going to be like decent third-line talents more so than first- or second-line scorers.
And you were mentioning earlier, you know, if the Flames are out of it and they make trades, and everywhere you look, people are talking about how close the league is this year. And, you know, the fact that even though the Flames are 3 points up from Edmonton and second from the bottom, that there's still a chance they could be back in this. So I think it's interesting over the past week, if you look at the trades that have been made, the Shen deal and the Jones deal, you're almost seeing trade deadline caliber trades at this point in the season. And I think it's going to be really interesting to look at what happens at the deadline. I think we might have one of the most uneventful trade deadlines in history.
Well, it really depends on where the standings are. Like, I know the Flames, if they're out of it, I think that we could see five or six players getting dealt, even players that are under contract for next year, because a guy like Englund or Smead, if the Flames eat part of his remaining contract, would be an affordable option as a 6-7 defenseman for a playoff team.
You know, speaking of eating contracts, one thing I found out this week after the LA deals is I guess teams are only allowed to absorb part of a contract for three players.
Yeah.
I didn't know that there was a limit on it.
Yeah. It's not like you could just trade like half your team and eat half of the contracts, because that would be a way to get around the cap floor, I do suppose.
Yeah. I never really gave it much thought, but I didn't even know that there was a limit on it.
Yeah.
So,
and realistically, over the next two seasons, there's not really that many players that you would realistically need to eat money on anyway.
No.
So, it depends. Like, if you were to trade, say, Dennis Wiedemann, that would likely require you eating, like, $2 million of that. Mm-hmm. But that's another discussion entirely.
Yeah, another discussion for another time. And I think, you know, we can speculate on that a lot. And maybe as we get close to the deadline, we will. But if the whole league, not just Calgary, but if the whole league stays like it is, I think it's going to be, you know, even teams making a gut decision. Like, I can't see Calgary being out of it. Even Edmonton could feasibly get back into this at this point.
Oh, yeah. Well, when McDavid comes back, I'm fully expecting them to propel themselves up the standings quite a bit. So we'll see.
Yeah, and I think, you know, if you look at it that way, it's going to be interesting because some GM at some time is going to have to just say, you know what, even though I might be 3 points out of it, I'm deciding that I'm going to sell because it's better for the future of my team.
And if you look at Calgary last year, that's what they did. And they moved their only UFA in Glenn Cross and the player that wanted to be traded in Berchi. And it didn't impact the team whatsoever. And we ended up getting enough assets where we could go and acquire Dougie Hamilton. So if at the deadline the Flames have to move away from Hudler and Russell and a couple other players, at least their assets can be used either at the draft, using the draft picks themselves, or in trade for something else to move forward organizationally.
How would you feel if the Flames were, say, 2 or 4 points out of a playoff picture at the deadline and Trilivan went ahead and started becoming a seller?
I would actually be encouraging it because of the fact that the Flames are still in a rebuild. If the Flames make the playoffs, realistically, they're not going to win the Stanley Cup. And you need to borrow a phrase from Jay Feaster, you need to have intellectual honesty and realize that the Flames need about 4 or 5 more pieces. Not necessarily like star players like Gaudreau, but just quality second line, third line guys in order to become a true contender for the Stanley Cup. And the Flames aren't there yet. So, yes, it would suck that to blow it up while there's still a chance to make the playoffs, but if you're looking for the long-term health and viability, like, I would much rather miss the playoffs, even though they're close, by dealing off a bunch of guys, if that means that the Flames are getting assets that can build them towards winning a Stanley Cup 2 years from now.
Yeah, I totally agree with you. I think if the Flames have to make a decision between playoffs this year and success in the future, I think you mortgage now for later. And I would not be opposed, even if they were, I mean, if we have, you know, a handed lead on another team in the playoffs, you don't want to forego that. But if it's, you know, 2, 4, even 6 or 8 point difference between us and somebody else, I think you err on the side of the future.
Yeah. And realistically, if the Flames were to trade Russell and Hudler only as the two main UFAs, I don't see that being such a huge blow that the Flames couldn't overcome that, even missing those players. So, like, we were more than able to manage when Giordano went down last year, and we were further out than, I think we were 4 points out at the time that his injury happened. So,
well, not just that late in the season, it's easy to bring up a guy like Nacladall or somebody who's playing well, on the farm and give them, I don't know how many games are left at that point, 15, 20 games to try them out, as opposed to trying to give one of them, 50 games.
Exactly.
So, I definitely think that it's pretty easy at that point to bring somebody in, maybe not in a top two role, but we have the depth that we can move some guys around a little bit and bring up a guy like Nacladall on a second or third pairing. No problem.
Yeah, and that's one of the good things of having as much depth as we do have organizationally, that we can make do with certain players not being there.
Exactly. And it's part of that pain of making a trade, right? Is you move a guy and now you have to fill, but sometimes filling the spots actually is a blessing because it's showing you someone that you didn't know could do that.
Look at David Schlemko coming in last year.
Yeah, exactly.
And he got a contract with another team because of it, even though he was looking like, prior to that being waived twice, that he was on his way out of the NHL. And instead, he's playing really well in New Jersey, and it looks like he's revitalized his career to an extent.
Yeah. No, I totally agree. It always happens. And, maybe we bring up a guy who's been struggling, like a Poirier, and all of a sudden he turns things around, and, we say, okay, this guy is worth keeping around. I know there's a lot of people sour on him this year.
Yeah, well, he's changing how he approaches the game offensively, so that makes sense why he's struggling. It's not like he's doing the exact same thing and it's just not working for him. He's trying to sort of transform himself into more of a Camilleri type, where he's getting into a good position to take one-timers, because he does have a good shot, instead of just his only move basically being driving towards the net and scoring. Because that won't work in the NHL, because defenders are a lot quicker than in the QMJHL.
Well, and even as I talked to Theo Fleury about a couple of weeks ago, it's that learning to play without the puck. He's so used to being that star guy and always being fed the puck, and it's about learning how to play without the puck and how to get that puck back in your stick and play a little bit more defensively.
Mm-hmm. And typically, most players take until they're 23, 24 to figure it out anyway. And like, if you look at Detroit, they've got guys that are in the AHL that would be in the NHL pretty much on any other team, but they're being patient and allowing them to work out all the kinks down there. And like, a guy like Andreas Anastasio is a really dynamite player. But yet I think he's only played like 7 or 8 games this year for Detroit. And he's being eased into the game, even though he is a similarly fast forward like Poirier. They're just being a lot more patient. So it's actually a good thing that the Flames are allowing Poirier and guys like Klimchuk and that the time to just work out all the kinks. So when they do come up, they are legit NHL players that can be useful for a long time instead of trying to learn on the job.
And that's the luxury we have of being in a rebuild position and being, fairly deep into that, where it's not year one and we're just trying to flesh out our roster quickly. We have that time to say, okay, let's give this guy, some time to play with things and to try things and to experiment and come up with the game that he needs to play.
Yeah, and having players, as much as we've, and a lot of Flames fans malign them, guys like Raymond and Bullig and Stajan and all the other guys that are just okay, they're useful in that regard, so you're not shoehorning players that might not necessarily be ready into spots that they're not ready for.
Exactly. And that's why those guys have jobs, you know? I mean, they're there to hold down those spots and to make it so that young guys have to beat them to get those spots back.
And that will come. It's just, it takes time.
For sure. Matt, would you say, looking at the trade deadline as a whole, not just for Calgary, do you think we're going to see a lot more deals like the Seth Jones trade, where it's really a one-for-one addressing need with teams?
I could see it, especially if you have teams that are all, like, if most of the teams are really close, I think you see, oh, well, we really need a defenseman, but we have seven top six forwards, so let's see if there's an overlap there. And I could even see the Flames partaking in such a trade as well, where, like, say, trading either Russell or Weidman for basically a second line forward or third line forward that's decent as a possibility. It might not necessarily be trading players for draft picks, but for other useful pieces moving forward.
Yeah, I agree. I think we're going to see teams so tight that we're not going to see a lot of, you know, trades where we're seeing four or five guys moving for one. I think you're going to see a lot of one-for-one deals or two-for-two deals, similar to the Cavalier deal. And I think that it's going to be interesting because I think teams have to be more frugal in a way of not just overspending and splurging at this time. And I think you're going to have people that are trying to go out and buy because they're going, hey, I'm 2 points out of the playoffs, but I don't know you're going to have those kind of sellers. Because the sellers are in a buying position as well.
Well, that's why if Calgary is like 6 or 8 points out at the deadline, I think you would see them being like the one-stop shop because you need an offensive defenseman. Here's Weidman. You need a decent third-line winger. You got Jones. You need a top-six winger. You got Hudler. So there are a lot of options. Like, you need a goalie. We have two. So it just depends, and we'll see.
And depending on how much Trelivan wants to strip this team down for its parts, there might be a lot to sell there.
True. And if you're looking at organizationally, I think that guys like Nakladol, Wotherspoon, Kulak, they can all easily slot in the NHL and not really be out of place at this point. And on the forward group, there's guys like Derek Grant, Augustino, Bill Arnold, Poirier, Freddie Hamilton, and Drew Shore. All those guys can slot in as well. So, if need be, like in terms of the raw talent difference between, say, a guy like David Jones and Drew Shore, I don't really see there's much of a huge drop-off from one to the other. It's just more experience than anything. So if the Flames do go into like full teardown mode, I don't really see that the Flames would be losing all that much.
No, and there's no need for a teardown, but as you always say, you know, it depends on what the offer is. It depends what comes our way. And if there are a bunch of greedy sellers out there looking to buy and we can make a quick buck, it might be worth it.
True. And assets can always be flipped. Like, I don't think the Flames went into the draft last year expecting Dougie Hamilton to fall in their lap.
No, I wouldn't expect it.
But they had the assets available that Boston wanted. They wanted plenty of top 50 draft picks. We gave them three. And that was only possible due to trading Glenn Cross and Berchi. So, we'll see. And there's no wrong way of going about it other than just standing pat. I think if the Flames make trades, I think they will be selling, even if they are in a playoff spot. We'll just have to see when that comes, to what extent the selling will be.
Yeah, I think if we walk out of the season with Hudler and Russell both not under contract and Flames who become free agents, that's the only way that we can really fail.
Mm-hmm. And if you only trade one of them, that's fine. Like, if you're wanting to maintain a playoff push and you keep, say, Hudler, that's fine, I suppose, but We'll see.
I think that how Hiller plays from now until then is going to be a big part of that, too. I think the Flames are starting to lose a little bit of faith in him, and they might decide that he's just going to be easier to move.
Yeah, and I think at the deadline, if you got even a fifth-round pick for Hiller, even if you had to eat half of his remaining contract, I think that'd be acceptable.
Oh, I thought you were saying Hudler.
Hiller.
Oh, sorry. Yeah, no, I think Hudler, it's going to depend how he plays from now until the end after coming back from his injury. Hiller, I think you just move him for whatever you can get. A name that I've heard some people throwing around lately is a guy who we should look at trading because they're saying he's slumping is Sean Monahan. What are your thoughts on Monty this season?
He didn't have a sophomore slump last year, and when I think pretty much everybody was expecting it. And it seems like it's coming a year later than what everybody expected. We'll see. He's not being as authoritative, at least until recently. He's been playing a lot better the last couple of games. Every young player has ups and downs, unless you're Johnny Gaudreau. And, you know, it's frustrating to watch because of the fact that you're having a set of expectations that, okay, you scored 64 points or 63 points last year. We're expecting 70 or 75. That, unfortunately, is not how it works with young guys. Like, it's not like a veteran guy like a Ginla where you can pencil him in for 35 goals and 70 points. What he will ultimately be is still up in the air. And if he returns to form and develops into a top-line center, then that's great. If not, we have Sam Bennett. And that might be the possibility where he gets bumped down to the second line. And it's just a wait and see. Like, that's part of the problem with a rebuild is you need to be patient with young players because they do screw up.
And even if you look at the numbers, in 2012-2013, Monahan played 75 games. He had 22 goals and 12 points for 34, or 22 goals and 12 assists for 34 total points. Not what you want to see, but that's his rookie year. Okay.
Yeah, also have to remember his line mates that year. The reason why he had so many goals and so few assists was his line mates were non-existent in terms of offensive skill. So
then last year he played 81 games and had 62 points, and this year he's got 41 games and 28 points. So he's on projection, if he keeps these numbers up, do 56 points this year. And I think if he can reach even 50, he's exactly where I'm expecting him to be.
Yeah, and you know, fans also need to remember that last year he didn't have that many points in the early half of the season. And I think he's only like 5 or 6 points off of his pace from a year ago. So, yeah, it's, I don't know, it's overblown in my point of view. Like, he's a good player. He will be a good player for a long time. So, you know, if he's not a 70-80 point player, he's still a very effective two-way guy. So
I think he's the right partner right now for Gaudreau.
Yeah, because he's allowing Gaudreau to do whatever he wants, basically.
And I think that he will have a place with this team for a long time, whether it's a number one center or a number two center. I think he's a guy we want to keep around here. I would be very upset if the Flames traded him away because I think he's still a young player who's still developing and we need to see what we have out of this guy.
Yeah, I don't honestly, I have no idea why anybody would want to trade Monahan away. Like, if you look at a guy like, I know this is going to be a outlandish comparison, but if you look at Jonathan Toews on Chicago, he doesn't get a lot of points. He's renowned, though, for being a good quality two-way player. So if the Flames are able to mold him into a similar sort of guy where he's getting 60-ish points a year, but is a good shutdown center as well, then that will be nothing but awesome when the Flames do try to win a Stanley Cup in a couple seasons. Like, unless you're getting, I don't know, like, who I would even trade him one for one for. That's how, you know, like, if the Flames were to trade him, you'd pretty much need to get, like, Erik Karlsson or somebody that's that good in order for it to make sense. And even then, why would you? Like, a 6'3" center, first line center, does not grow on trees. Like, you're lucky if you get one, period.
I think a lot of people are comparing him to Johnny Gaudreau. And his numbers aren't there where Gaudreau is, but if you look on most teams, you don't have two guys with those kind of numbers. So I think that Monahan's definitely worth re-signing. I think Monahan's definitely worth paying $5 million plus. And you know what? Maybe he does. Maybe Bennett ends up being a better partner there. But I sort of like the Gaudreau-Monahan pairing and then having Bennett on line two to create that constant scoring threat.
Yeah. And if you look at the 28 points that Monahan has, like, that's good for 72nd overall in the NHL. So that's a first-line player in terms of just raw offensive numbers. And I'm going to just check one sec to see how many centers are ahead of him.
Sure. While you're doing that, why don't I just give a quick injury recap for the Flames? We have Micheal Ferland, who's back in practice after his long-term injury. He's wearing the yellow jersey, which means no contact, but it's expected that he'll be back for the Flames very shortly here, which is good to see. I've been a Ferland fan since we got him, and I think that the team has definitely suffered without him. Jari Hudler is expected to be back in the lineup on Wednesday against the Panthers. I'll be curious to see if they put him on the first line or if they put him somewhere else, but he should be back in the lineup and ready to go. And Lance Boma, he's had a tough season. He was out for a while. He's been back in for about 8 games. And in the San Jose Sharks game, he got cut on the leg, and he's now out for what's expected to be a couple weeks with a lower body injury. So the Flames are going to have to make do without Boma again. But it'll be interesting to see what happens to the lineup and who's going to slot back in on a regular basis.
Yeah, it's not been a very good season for Lance Boma, unfortunately. After coming off a career year, then having two very significant injuries pretty much back-to-back,
that's
frustrating.
That's what I was going to say, too, is after the great year he had, this is the year you were expecting him to do even better, and having two significant injuries really makes that tough for him. So I'll be curious to see what happens next year. Hopefully he'll be healthy. And if he, you know, some of these guys, they have a good year and then they get hurt and they just never recover back to the same form. I'll be curious to see if that's Boma or if he comes back healthy next year and we see him have a great year again.
Mm-hmm. And as for Monahan, he is currently tied for 33rd amongst centers. And if he had two more points this year, he'd be in the top 20. Or three more points, he'd be in the top 20. So, yeah, that's more than acceptable. The Flames aren't one of the higher scoring teams as well, so the numbers are a little depressed because of that.
And that's a good point, too. If the Flames were number one in the West or number one in the Pacific, we might be having a different conversation. But I think both those guys, him and Gaudreau, and even a guy like Bennett, their scoring is about on pace for where this team is and what we're seeing from this team on the ice.
Yeah, because Calgary was one of the top 10 teams last year in terms of offense, and I think they're like the 8th worst team or something like that this year. So it does make quite a bit of difference.
For sure. Well, the big news coming out of Calgary this week is the retirement of one of the Flames' former defenseman, a guy who is still well-loved here, and that's Robyn Regehr. The Flames signed Regehr to a one-day contract so he could retire as a Flame, which when I heard the news, I was talking to a friend of mine. I said, I thought he was already retired. Like, he just kind of faded away into nothing, and I'm glad he retired as a Flame. When I think of Robyn Regehr, I still identify him as a Calgary Flame. How about you?
Oh, for sure. His time in both LA and Buffalo were just okay. He didn't really stand out in either place. And I'm glad that the Flames offered him a position in the organization as well. And it'll be nice to see him around the team.
Yeah, I'll be curious to see what he's doing. I mean, if you remember Connie when he first got his job here, he was a special assistant, which nobody really knew what that meant. But it'll be curious to see what Robyn Regehr does as a, you know, member of the Flames. And the fact that he moved back to Calgary from L.A. after he retired, that really tells you something about this city and about the hockey community here. For a guy to, you know, give up L.A., especially in his retirement in his, you know, mid-30s, to come here. So it's good to see Robyn back.
Yeah, it was nice to see the fans giving him a standing ovation yesterday.
I've never been a huge fan of the, you know, sign a guy to one day to have him retire with your team, but I guess that's better than doing what we've seen in the past, which was trade for a guy at the deadline the year that he's, you know, going to retire and play him here for 20 games, do the same thing.
Yeah.
Interesting fact about Robyn Regehr that not a lot of people know is Robyn Regehr was drafted by Colorado and actually didn't come to the Flames until later. He hadn't played in the NHL yet, but he was part of the Theo Fleury deal. He was, I believe, the player to be named later in that deal from the prospects that we were getting. And at the time, Robyn Regehr had two broken legs. He'd actually had a snowmobile accident, I think, and had two broken legs. So it was kind of Colorado dumping a prospect, saying, oh, we don't want this guy. You know, you take him. And it turned out really well for the Flames. I'd say if you look back at that Theo Fleury deal, he was really the key piece of it in the long term for the Flames.
Yeah, it's sort of like the Flames wanting Todd Harvey from Dallas for Joe Nieuwendyk, and they had to settle for Jerome Iginla.
They made a good choice.
Well, it was kind of thrust upon them, so, you know. They've kind of backed into a couple of good things in the last 20 years.
So, yeah, if you look at that deal for Theo Fleury, we gave up Theo Fleury and Chris Dingman. We got Wade Bielak, Rene Corbet, second-round pick, which ended up being Jared Stoll, and future considerations, which was Robyn Regehr. So I think if we look at that, Regehr was definitely the guy who lasted here the longest.
Yeah. And funny note about Chris Dingman, probably the worst player to win two Stanley Cups.
Does he have two rings?
Yep. He was with Tampa Bay when they beat us, and he was with Colorado when Ray Bourque won his cup there, so...
Wow.
Just an odd...
Yeah, I didn't even realize that he had to, but yeah, you're right. Huh. Cool. Well, good for him.
Yeah.
Any memories of Robyn Regehr you want to share? Anything about Robyn as we look back in his career?
Well, the famous rivalry that he had with Alex Hemsky was always awesome.
Yeah, it would have been interesting to talk to Alex this past week and see what he thinks of Regehr.
Thank God he's not playing anymore.
Regehr should invite him to the press conference just to check him.
Yeah.
and
one for old time's sake.
And, you know, we look back at that era, and Robyn Regehr and Dion Phaneuf were really anchoring the Flames' blue line then, and it's interesting the difference in how their careers went. You know, we had Phaneuf, who went on to Toronto and really became the big star there, and Regehr, who played in Calgary, was always a good guy, ended up getting lost in the shuffle after he left here. But I would argue, I think, of the two of them, if I was building a team, I would rather have Robyn than Dion.
Oh, for sure. Easily.
And for those that don't know, the reason Robyn Regehr left the Flames is on June 25th, 2011, I believe that was at the NHL draft, the Flames made a trade, finally getting rid of Alex Kodelik, the guy that never should have been in a Flame to start with. They traded Alex Kodelik and Robyn Regehr in a second-round pick, which I believe ended up being Jake McCabe, to the Buffalo Sabres in exchange for Chris Butler and Paul Byron. So probably didn't get what he was worth, but we were just trying to get rid of Kodelik, and he got caught in the crossfire, I think.
Yeah. And I think the Flames at the time were trying to figure out a way to acquire Brad Richards, so... That's another reason why they wanted to clear out so much cash.
Trying to make some cap room.
Yeah, which I'm glad that didn't happen.
It's interesting, if you look at that draft, the Calgary Flames drafted 42nd in the pick that came from Buffalo, and Buffalo drafted 44th in the pick that came from Calgary. Calgary drafted Patrick Seeloff, and Buffalo drafted Jake McCabe. And I think in hindsight, we probably would have rather had Jake McCabe.
Yeah.
It's always interesting to look back at drafts that way and see who did what and why.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, I'm glad that Regehr's back. I'll be curious. They haven't officially announced what his position in the organization is, have they?
No.
I haven't seen it either.
But I'm assuming it's going to be basically what Conroy did initially.
Yeah, or some sort of an ambassador role. I can see him kind of... He's still young. I can see him being the sort of... What Poplinski's done a lot of, and that's kind of being that alumni guy who goes and does the pond hockey and does the kids' hockey stuff in the community and that sort of thing.
Mm-hmm.
Or maybe we'll see him behind the bench next year with Jelena as the defensive coach. You never know.
Yeah.
But I'm glad
he's
back.
Watch out, Martin.
That's right. I'm glad he's back. I think it's good that he's part of the organization here. I don't have one specific Regehr memory as a Flame, but he was always a guy who I thought was a hard worker. Regehr never seemed to take a night off. And when I look back at memories of him and footage of him, he was always a scary guy for other forwards to play against.
Yeah. Well, anytime you went into his corner, you pretty much knew that you were going to have a visit with the boards and the glass.
Yeah, for sure.
Whether your name was Hemsky or Sidney Crosby or anybody else, really. So
Well, and it's funny because Hemsky, I think, you know, the rivalry was there partly just because of how many games the Flames and the Oilers played. It's not necessarily that he was singling out Hemsky. They just happened to play against each other a lot.
Well, I recall an after-hours thing interview with Regehr, and he said that early in his career, Hemsky cross-checked Regehr in the face. And that was a little bit of having to do with the constant attention.
Oh, was it? Okay.
So
interesting. Matt, it's time for our weekly predictions game, as always. And as usual, this is sponsored by TickTix. TickTix connects the sea of red to buy and sell tickets securely from their phones. TickTix lets sellers sell for free and verifies the sellers so the buyers don't get ripped off. When you buy tickets from the app, tickets are delivered digitally, so there's no hassle in trying to pick them up. Download TickTix today in the Google Play Store or iOS App Store. Get your tickets and come see the Flames, and let's cheer them on and hope they can make it through January with a +500 record.
Yeah, and over the next couple of weeks after tomorrow's game against Florida, the Flames actually only play in town once in the next 3 weeks. So there won't be a lot of opportunities in the near future to go to Flames games, but if you can, use TickTix.
Well, and I mean, if you look at it too, we're in January already. This season's over, you know, in early April, so the longer we wait, the less games there are to go to. And I think that if you want to see the team in its current incarnation, now's the time to go, because I think moves are going to start happening based on what we're seeing around the league soon. So grab some tickets, whether it's this month or buy in advance. Go to a game in February. Go to a game in March. There's a game just after Valentine's Day, so you can take your Valentine to a game. But yeah, definitely get out to one of the games that's coming up soon. So Matt, last week we had 6 points on the table. We had 3 games. We did our predictions as usual. I thought the Flames would walk away with 4 points and 2 wins. I thought they'd beat San Jose and Arizona, and you walked away with 2 points. And you thought they'd beat just Arizona. And the Flames did get 2 points, but it came over a win with Tampa Bay. And I was trash-talking you a bit last week.
Yeah.
I said, you know, you're not doing too well here, and now you come out and win.
Yeah, exactly. So anytime I get made fun of, it seems that fortunes change. And unfortunately for the Flames, that came at the cost of getting more than 2 points this week.
All right, well, I'm not going to make fun of you. That way you don't beat me this week.
Yeah. Well,
so
it's actually kind of interesting.
You
were exactly wrong on every game.
I was. Yeah, the two that we lost, I thought we'd win. The one that we won, I thought we'd lost. And, I mean, you didn't. You got lucky because you picked the wrong team that we were going to beat, but based on the rules of the game, you got 1 point. So now I have 2 points and you have 3 points.
First time since the first week of the season I've been correct. Yes.
Yeah, but you've still been leading the game all season. We tied last week and now you're back in the lead.
Yeah. Well, some things just can't stand. And, you know, you being even tied with me is just not acceptable.
I guess I'm like Kari Ramo. I've done a good job of, you know, keeping the pucks out of my net.
Yeah.
And letting the offense tie us up. We have a busy schedule until we talk next. We have the Florida Panthers who are going to be coming to the Dome. That's going to be on Wednesday night. It's a 7:30 start. Then the Flames get a couple days off, and they're going to be going up to Edmonton. And those are the next two games that we're going to be playing. And I guess we'll be pretty much talking on the 18th before the really busy schedule. So we've only got the two games, but I think two important games for the Flames. Matt, what are your thoughts? How do you think we're going to do in those two games?
Well, Florida is red hot. They've won 12 of their last 13 and have collected 25 of the 26 points, which is remarkable. They haven't really been playing all that well. They've been... Like, any time a team has a protracted winning streak, you start seeing bad things enter their game. So, I'm not exactly sure what to expect from tomorrow. I think the Flames could win if we play our game, but I think the Flames will end up dropping that one, and I think we will beat the Oilers.
So you're going 2 points, and you're giving the win in the Edmonton game.
Yes.
I'd already put my predictions down before I asked you, and I was the exact same. I think the Flames are going to struggle with Florida. I think, especially coming off two losses, I don't know they're going to be able to beat Florida, and I think Florida's shown lately that they're hot, and I don't see any signs of that letting up. So I think we lose to Florida. And I think that the Flames know that they have to beat Edmonton.
All right, I'll change mine to 4 points.
4 points?
That way we're not the exact same.
All right, so you think we're going to sweep?
Yeah, sure, why not?
All right, we can be the same. It doesn't matter.
Well, it makes it less fun because then, we'll have, whether we're right or wrong, we'll have the exact same thing. So,
yeah, I locked mine in at the beginning of the show. So
yeah. I'll change mine. That's no big deal.
Okay, so you're going to do 4 points that we win both. I think we're going to beat Edmonton, and I think we have to beat Edmonton. If we don't, I mean, they're going to be creeping up on us very quickly.
Well,
and
I think if the Flames don't win both, I think we'll start to slide far enough out where we would require another 7 or 8 game winning streak just to get back into it. And at that rate, if you're needing that kind of a streak, then you might as well just pack it in.
And if you look, I mean, we don't have that many. We see the Flames play very well at home and very poorly on the road, and the Edmonton game starts a 5-game road swing. And the last time we even have remotely, five or six home games in a row is not till March, when over, 2 weeks we have 6 games at home. So unless we can start winning on the road and start putting those road wins together, I think we're going to slide quite far out of this if we're not winning.
Yeah. We'll see. Everything's in the Flames' hands, whether they push for a playoff spot or they are in the running to get Matthews or Puljujarvi. We'll see.
That's all you can do, is just wait and see how the month ends.
Yeah, and it'll be interesting one way or the other. Either we'll be gearing up for the playoffs or looking ahead to the trade deadline to see who and for what we can make deals with. So,
well, and I think it could be interesting too, because if we look at the volume and quality of deals that have been made over the last little bit, I wouldn't be surprised to see one of those deals happening, before next week.
Anything's possible.
All right, Matt, well, you enjoy your week, and we will talk to you again next week.
Take care, everybody. Thanks for listening once again.
Have a good one.
Bye.
Fireside Chat is hosted by Dan Stevenson, co-hosted by Matt DeBorg. This episode produced and edited by Peter Marino. Fireside Chat is licensed under a Creative Commons license. For full license details, visit firesidechat.ca.